Hare Krishna. That was my back. So we are very, very honored and fortunate to have with us this evening His Holiness Sachinandan Maharaj. And it's also very nice to see all the devotees who've gathered to honor this opportunity at such good association. So just in a few moments with Maharaj, his association is very calming, very enlivening, very inspiring, very uplifting. We're very grateful to Maharaj for coming and giving us his association, making time in his busy schedule. So please, if we can all join together to express our appreciation of Maharaj coming and encourage him in a very tumultuous way to please always keep London in his heart and to come back here again and again by chanting very, very, very loudly three Hari Bols. That was pretty good. Even louder. Three Hari Bols. His Holiness Sachinandan Maharaj Ki. So this evening, Maharaj will help us to remove the inner darkness from our hearts. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. That was very loud. You cannot believe what it means for me to come before Shishi Radha London Ishvara, because you are not in my skin. You're not in my situation. I was very, very young, maybe 16, maybe 15, between 15 and 16 years, when I came in contact with Shishi Radha London Ishvara. They were at that time at the Bury Street Temple, and I fell in love with them. I was still not shaved up, not a monk. I had not decided to become a devotee of Krishna, but because I was chanting every morning before these beautiful deities and praying to them for directions in my life, I could finally get the inspiration necessary to go on the path of Krishna consciousness. So I really owe my present life and my present enthusiasm to Shishi Radha London Ishvara. It's a very moving moment for me whenever I come, which is unfortunately a little rare, but they mean very much for me. They have given me birth in my spiritual path of Krishna consciousness. Very wonderful. So I will talk to you about overcoming inner darkness. I will not be able to address the babies with my talk. That means the babies will become very bored with what I will say and will need their parents to take care of them. So if you have a little child or little children, you might have to take care of them outside. Thank you. Good. I think our time limit is 7 o'clock when the Artik starts, isn't it? So that's enough. That's enough. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunya Vihari. yadata matapa kunya bihadi. Gopi dana vallava giri varadaji. Gopi dana vallava giri varadaji. Nandana braja jana ranjana yasoda nandana braja jana ranjana Jamuna tira vana chari. Jamuna tira vana chari. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama. Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama. Rama Rama Hare Hare Yesa Hare Krishna
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada. Jaya Radha, Londonishvara Radha, Londonishvara Radha. Premanandi, Hari 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 Bo.
Hare Krishna. Knowing well that our time is limited to 25 minutes. Let us see. I request your full participation, a full attention and everything. It is very nice to see that you have come here in this warm temple atmosphere, and I just need to do one more announcement. Really, it's very important for me that we have a peaceful and undisturbed time. So if my dear mother, if your child needs something, please do take care of the needs so that there's not a loud child all the time. I will build this text, which I have prepared for today, into my class. Gaurahari will find it here. I would like to talk about something which is just so crucial and which is so important in our spiritual lives, but something which I feel does not always get the attention in our lectures. So I will try to address this, and I do hope that you will be able to understand first of all what is the subject matter, and I also do understand that I do hope that when you leave this sacred room, this temple room today, later in the evening, I really sincerely hope that you will take something with you from the class which will accompany you and be with you for a long time to go and help you to to significantly advance in Krishna consciousness. So, Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Simate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Nitti Namine Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Bhaskatyare Satarine Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Garadhara Shivasadi Gaur Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. There are two types of darknesses. One is the outer darkness, which we all know very well, a darkness which settles in when the sun sets and which is today very, very, very strong because we have the new moon today. New moon means no moon. That's the outer darkness. Will be very dark today. And then there is a second type of darkness, which is the inner darkness. And I would like to talk specifically about this inner darkness because unfortunately it's something which is not getting enough attention in our spiritual life. Or we might think, everyone has this inner darkness except for me. I feel very... where is my darkness? Can you see? I'm dressed in white colors or saffron colors and no darkness. You will be shocked what you hear in a little bit, in a little while. So, man has always felt threatened by outer darkness. They have built fires in the night, and then they have invented electricity so that the darkness is not so much prevalent. In old London, you might have noticed or known that there were these old lanterns, and there was a lantern man who went in the darkness in the night and lit the lanterns, and he also had to maintain the lantern so that Jack the Ripper could not commit violence because we know in darkness dangerous elements come, or danger comes when there is darkness all around us. We don't even know which way to take. We run against walls and trees, and we all feel instinctively when we go through a dark forest in the night and we hear the voices. Ooh, ooh. Count Dracula is chasing me. You know, we feel like that. Or when we hear a snake is in the underwood and he's out to bite me into my heel. I know it. You know. Human beings feel threatened by darkness because they just can't see their path any longer. And they don't know how to react when something unforeseen happens, and therefore have invented electricity, have taken the help of fire, and are relieved when the full moon is there after the dark moon period is over. During the day, human beings in the early morning, they wait for the sun to rise, and this period, just briefly before sunrise, the Brahma Muhurta has been considered by the human beings at the most auspicious period, because soon the darkness is over and the sun is there. Man has always felt threatened by outer darkness, but what is about inner darkness? First of all, what does it mean? And what can we do? I feel the inner darkness is even more threatening, because it's a covering of the soul. When the soul is covered, it means you are covered. You are simply not there. Just like when I cover my bead bag, then the bead bag has disappeared. I often look for my bead bag. I'm asking Gaurahari, where's my bead bag? Where's my bead bag? And Gaurahari already knows what to answer. Most probably it's underneath your Uttariya, it's covered. Remove the covering, then you have it. And yes, it's here. So when the soul is covered, then you are lost for all purposes. What covers the soul? Patanjali has made it very clear what are the five coverings of the soul, and they have found the entry in the Bhagavatam. They are described. The first covering of the soul is called avidya. I think you must be knowing the ignorance of the spiritual, our spiritual identity. And then comes asmita. Smita means smiling, and asmita means the exact opposite. Asmita means the false ego. It's nothing to smile about. It's very bad. Asmita means false ego, which is the immediate result of avidya, of ignorance. When you don't know who you are, then you're forced to develop a false sense of identity. From this, avidya and asmita, the compound ignorance and compound ego, sometimes it's described to be a knot in the heart, develop three unpleasant things which you might know in from your life. Raga is you become attached to something which is material. And dvesha, you become repulsed by it. By the way, attachment and repulsion has the same force of haunting you. Sometimes repulsion haunts you even more. You know, I don't like this person. And you, for 24 hours of a day, you think about this person with that dvesha. You know? And finally, and often we see in the material atmosphere that raga or deep attachment turns into repulsion. Look at the marriages today and at the divorce rate, which shows that people who were previously linked with affectionate feelings are now meeting before a lawyer and only talking through a lawyer with each other. And finally, the third problem is abhinivesha. Abhinivesha means total material absorption. This is called the darkness of the soul, or the covering of the soul. It is very, very terrible, because as long as this persists, samsara persists. That is the repetition of birth and death. As long as you have avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, and abhinivesha in your heart, your term of imprisonment in the material world persists. The covering of the soul is fivefold, and it cannot be removed by the sun, it can't be removed by the moon, it can't be removed by fire, and not even by all the strong electricity which you might find in England. It's so heavy. That covering of the soul creates karma, material desires, and material desires create karma, with an R, karma. Your repetition of birth and death in this world. It's a very, very, very heavy thing. The Vedic scriptures say, Tamasi ma jyotir gamaha. Come out of the darkness. What darkness do they speak about? Is it the darkness in a room you have to come out? No, it's the darkness of the heart, the darkness of the soul, the inner darkness. Come out of the darkness. Follow the path of light. What is the light? Is it electricity or is it fire? No, the light which we have to follow in our life is the light of Krishna. Only Krishna has that type of light which is necessary to dispel the inner darkness. And this is the subject matter of our verse today. Yes. Which you will find here. Please chant it with me. I brought my orchestra with me here. Tesham evanukampatam. Aham agyana jam tamaha nashayam yatma bhavasto jnana dipena bhashvata tesham evanukampatam. Aham agyana jantama nashayam yatma bhavasto jnana dipena bhashvata tesham evanukampatam. Aham agyana yantamaha tesham evanukampatam. Aham agyana yantamaha nashayam yatma bhavasto jnana dipena bhashvata shayam yatma bhavasto jnana dipena bhashvata tesham evanukampatam. Tesham evanukampatam. Aham agyana yantama nashayam yatma bhavasto jnana dipena bhashvata So, Krishna describes here that when he becomes mercifully inclined to someone, he appears in that heart of that person and takes the shining lamp of knowledge, it's like a torch, torchlight, and dispels that darkness born of avidya, of ignorance. I will read to you the verse, and I hope that you will be able to be fully attentive while I read this verse, because it might save your life. To show them special mercy, I, dwelling in their hearts, destroy with the shining lamp of knowledge the darkness which is born of ignorance. Krishna, in the fifth chapter, speaks about the effect of this knowledge. What does this knowledge do which Krishna gives you? He says, this knowledge will reveal everything. It will reveal what you should do. It will, let's start somewhere else. It will reveal your sambandha, who you are, and how you are related to Krishna. It will show you what you really are. Not. It will demask you at first from this terrible mask ball. It will strip the mask away from your face, and but you will feel so relieved. You will know what you should do in your life. You will no longer be under the tyranny of your ignorance and of your falsity, and you will actually become enlightened. He speaks about this in the fifth chapter, text 16. What happens when the torchlight of knowledge goes on? He says, when, however, one is enlightened with the knowledge by which nations, agyana or avidya, is destroyed, then his knowledge reveals everything, just as the sun lights up everything in the darkness. And Srila Prabhupada tells us here, those who have forgotten Krishna must certainly be bewildered. They must be bewildered. But those who are in Krishna consciousness are not bewildered at all. What is that knowledge about which we speak? Knowledge is always highly esteemed, says Srila Prabhupada. And what is that knowledge? He answers his question. Perfect knowledge is achieved when one surrenders unto Krishna. As it is said in the seventh chapter, Bahunam janmanam ante jnanamam mang prapadyante. After passing through many, many births, when one is perfect in knowledge, one surrenders unto Krishna, or when one attains Krishna consciousness, then everything is revealed to him, as everything is revealed by the sun in the daytime. It's a beautiful purport. I encourage you to read that. But let me be here crystal clear. This darkness, inner darkness, is so intense. It can continue for many, many lifetimes. And there is no help. There is no solution. There is no way out of it. For many, many lifetimes, you can be forced to run around in total darkness, not knowing who you are, not knowing what your way is. You may come into the temple and adopt Krishna consciousness as a hobby and work for much of your time, but is that the solution, Krishna consciousness as a hobby? No, that doesn't help very much. It helps a little. You must come to the level where you can surrender to Krishna. And I want to say that is a high level in Krishna consciousness. Then that darkness goes, and that self-centered desire, which is so much in the heart, will go away. That was the self-centered desire for a moment. Do you know what they do when airplanes crash? They try to find the black box. What is the black box? It's what you have in your heart. The black box is what is in the also in the heart of the airplane. It's where all the information is stored. When did the airplane start? From where did it start? What were the possible stations it took? Maybe it was before it crashed for some time in London, you know, came from Moscow, landed in London, and then continued to Reykjavik, an island, and then it crashed somewhere over Greenland. And the black box tells you the record. All of you have such a black box in your heart, surrounding the soul. It's full of the information of the selfish desires, which are discussed here as raga and asmita, and which have accompanied you from Moscow to London to Reykjavik, or from your last birth somewhere, maybe in Gujarat, and then it took you to London, your next birth in London, and you can even study. If you know a little bit the art, I can look at that black box now if you want, and I can tell you where you go after this life. It's a certain art which you can study, but I won't do it because it can be so shocking. My dear devotees, what we are talking about is a serious problem, a black box of selfish desires, bringing us from one body to the next, from one station to the next. Every time our airplane crashes at the time of death, but the black box is still there with that information. Another flight to London. Then you crash at the end of this life in London, but the black box is still there. The journey continues, life after life after life. Shri Shri Radha Londoneeshwara Ki Jai. So, the only, I would like to read you something which I always read when I give this lecture. Do you know about Gajendra the elephant? We have heard. Gajendra the elephant was attacked brutally by a crocodile which had much more strength than him and which was pulling him for the ultimate kill into the water of the lake. You know, crocodiles take their victim by the leg. I've once seen that in my life, how I was chanting at the bank of a river and someone was attacked by a crocodile. They attack by the leg and then pull the victim into the deeper water and then go for the ultimate kill, mostly the throat. But this one started with the intestines. It was cruel. It was so cruel. Very vicious. Very vicious. So that elephant was attacked by the crocodile who was pulling him in the water to do something terrible to him. And he remembered his past life by this shocking moment, this danger in his life, and he somehow woke up from that elephant consciousness, you know, thinking he's an elephant, and thought and understood I'm a soul, eternal soul, and began to pray to the Lord by taking a lotus flower. And he first prayed for protection of his life, you know, save me from this. I don't know if you are attacked by a crocodile, my dear devotees, it's so, never forget this. I have nightmares even now because I tried to help by throwing things into the river, but of course the victim was killed before my eyes, brutally. They're so brutal, these crocodiles. So, I have to really switch to get away from this picture which comes to my mind. So first the elephant prayed for protection, like this man prayed, help me, help me, help me. But then the elephant understood, what is the use if I survive this? If I cannot be protected from this inner darkness, which will again force me to take another birth somewhere, where I will again have the same problems. I will die by the crocodile of death that will come. So I don't want to go on with this inner darkness. He prayed, I do not wish to live anymore, even if I'm released from the attack of that crocodile. What is the use of an elephant's body covered externally and internally by ignorance? I simply desire eternal liberation from the covering of ignorance. That covering is not destroyed even by the influence of time. So do you understand? There is, Prabhupada says, there is no need to live as an elephant or man, an American or Indian. There's no need to continue this. One should desire only to achieve liberation from the cycle of birth and death. Because of this ignorance or inner darkness, we consider every life offered by nature to be happy and pleasing. Then he continues. If you want to read this, my dear devotees, it's in the 8th canto, chapter 3, text 25. You know, the conclusion is not that there is no need for you to continue your life, jump in the Thames, and finish this embarrassing situation. No. Bring the sun, which dispels that inner darkness. In the scriptures, it is stated that there is a sun which is more powerful than the moon and the sun, an inner sun which can dispel the inner darkness. Would you like to know about this? Really? You can't go with your inner darkness into the, you know, to the light to stop that, or the sun or the moon or the fire even. The only thing which removes it is Krishna. But how can you get Krishna? We are so far away. We are so diverted, really. How can you get Krishna? My dear devotees, I brought good news for you, otherwise I would give this lecture. Bhaktivinoda Thakur speaks of the son of the holy name. Krishna, in his most merciful form, the holy name, which appears in the sky of the heart. You know, it's in, we speak of this inner dimension now. The sky of the heart, it appears on the horizon of that sky, and even if it appears slightly, then already the darkness starts to go, when of course you chant the holy name perfectly at that time, the sun of the holy name fully rises and then the darkness goes. Srila Prabhupada writes about this, I have not come to teach you, but only to request you, please chant the names of God. Please chant this Hare Krishna mantra. Be cleansed of your consciousness and understand your spiritual identity. Prabhupada speaks here about a level in chanting where we disconnect from the inner darkness. That level of chanting is when you understand that you are an eternal soul who has a relationship with Krishna in which he was long absent, and you now call out to Krishna as you do your chanting, and be cleansed of your material consciousness, that means that inner darkness, and then you will understand your spiritual identity. You understand who you are as a soul. You understand your service, which you are meant to perform. You understand your relationship with Krishna. Everything is revealed to you when this son of the holy name begins to rise in the sky of the heart. It is not within the capability of the living entity to destroy this darkness. Only Krishna can. And he does so in the form of this most merciful form, I wanted to say, the holy name. But I don't know if you know, I'm a member of the Hare Krishna movement. But I am a very investigative member, very curious member, very disturbingly curious member. And I found out most Hare Krishnas don't chant Hare Krishna. What I have seen over my many years, I've made photos of this. I can document my case very well. I have looked, I have given hundreds of retreats, you know, really, I've really done a good job. I found out they don't know how to chant. I was shocked at first when I found this out. Then I looked and I could see that there were different reasons, and maybe one reason is that you are the true friend. You bring some light from the altar. Thank you, Hare Krishna. We can all go. Please go all with your hand like this, because if we hand it around, no one will listen any longer, but just look at the lamp. I know you, Hare Krishnas. I'm one of you. I have studied you very carefully. Very carefully for 40 years. I have files on you. Huge files. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he said that there are two names, the real name and the shadow name. When you have only the shadow of something, let us say the shadow of a mango, when I say I'm very poor, you know, at the moment, I want to give everyone here a mango. I come so rarely to London, so what we will do is I take this one mango in the light, and then I project the shadow, and you all eat the shadow, huh, for economic reasons. you please eat the shadow Jainitai, or you please eat the shadow Anjana. Be satisfied with the shadow. You would remain so hungry. So if you chant the holy name, let me say, the shadow of the holy name, you remain spiritually hungry. You are starving. Only when you chant the real name will you be nourished, just like only someone who has the real meal can be nourished, not those who eat the shadow for economic reasons. We can't live a shadow life. We must live the real spiritual life. And that means we have to greet Krishna in his holy name in the heart. And now, what makes the difference between the shadow name and the real name? Bhaktivinoda Thakur says something which sounds very familiar to all of us. He says, he says like this: when the living entity, after many births, comes in contact with the sadhu will give him knowledge about who he is and who is Krishna. He will give him what is technically called Sambandha Gyan. You have heard this, Sambandha Gyan? Then he will give and when you chant, and when the devotee chant, he must chant with this Sambandha Gyan. That means you chant being mindful of your relationship. Sambandha means relationship to Krishna. Bhaktivinoda Thakur offers a little meditation that first you understand, you impregnate in your mind, you bring in your mind the realization, I'm an eternal soul. And then from that level, you begin to connect with Krishna as your only master. Then you understand that this chanting which you do is really a call for connection. Please accept me. Please accept me in your service. And when you are in that mood, then the magic of chanting can work. Then the sun starts to rise in your heart. Only then, otherwise more shadow, more darkness. Not spiritual nourishment. This is a very deep subject. It's a very deep concern in your own spiritual life. When will you come out of the shadow and enter the light of Krishna consciousness? It happens when you take the name of Krishna with that feeling of sambandha, a relationship. It's not complicated. All of you know this. Do you know in the beginning you had this realization? You had the realization, Krishna is my Lord. I will even surrender my university if it is for him. You joined or you became interested. Some of you didn't even marry, although you are from Gujarat. I have studied the ways of the Patels also. Because you were convinced, I am a part of Krishna. I'm already connected. This inner, but then came the accommodation phase, and later you might have again become connected with the material things. Now, at this moment, everyone looks at the lamp, so we have to put it away. It smokes a little, isn't it? You can follow the course of the lamp. But now it will smoke into the altar. Maybe a little bit out of the room, yes, then otherwise the deities will get all this smoke. So, Hare Krishna, I have said what I wanted to say. Now I will just say things in a different vein. My dear devotees, I'm very sorry that I spoke so rash to you, that I almost tried to wake you up, motivate you. It's like this. I have only one lecture here in the Soho Street, and I have somehow this desire to shake you a little bit, because I know it is good. If someone wants to help us, he will help us to wake a little, to wake us up. But I'm, you know, this lecture was also meant for myself. I'm not thinking I'm any, know anything or am better in this, but I just have become aware of this inner darkness. I was so surprised when I read how Gajendra the elephant spoke this very enlightened prayer, where he says, as long as this inner darkness is not gone, what is my life? You know, what is my life? You know, I was really moved when he expressed himself like this. So I wish you all the best on your own spiritual path to confront this inner darkness. It is a little painful in the beginning when you see, oh, I still have false ego, I have so many material desires. But don't become discouraged when you look and see the... look more to what can remove the darkness and become an expert chanter of the holy name, who knows how to chant the name like a child which cries for the mother, or in other words, with a sense of relationship. The child knows, my mother, my mother, my mother can help me, and in this way starts to call the names of the mother, and then mother picks him up. So that is something which I feel is very, very nice, and Krishna will definitely see this. I always love to remember how Draupadi was in her biggest, you know, in a big test, when she was attacked by these uncultured people, and when an attempt was made to disrobe her in a public assembly. We all know that Krishna came to her help at the end of this ordeal and supplied an unlimited amount of sari to cover her. But what you may not know is the discussion which Draupadi had with Krishna afterwards. Draupadi went to Krishna when there was a little private setting and said, why did you come so late? They almost had taken all the cloth away from me. Why so late? You wanted to come. Why did you come so late? And then Krishna said, listen, Draupadi, in the beginning, when they dragged you into that public assembly, you called my name, Krishna, Ojanadan, but you really didn't make a connection with me. You connected to Bhishma and said, Bhishma, save me. Then you continued with your disconnected chanting, oh, Krishna, Janadan, Govinda. And you said, all you kings, save me, please. This is an injustice. You chanted my name, but you really turned somewhere else. Only at the end, when you saw that neither Bhishma, nor the kings, nor Dhritarashtra, nor Duryodhana, no one protected you, then you tried to fight yourself in the beginning. You pulled, but you kept your sari like this, like a warrior lady. Today I drove through London and I saw a cinema poster, The Warrior Ladies of India. I hope they bring Draupadi also in that movie. So you fought like a warrior lady, but only at the very end you connected. You knew not even your own strengths would save you. You you raised your hands and called out for Krishna, for me, and you connected. And then I came and gave you all the cloth which you wanted. So Hare Krishna, thank you very, very much. I took a little bit extra time because of starting late. I have heard that there is more time now to chant before the deities. I suggest we just chant a little bit together, and we should turn to Radha London Ishvara. please do turn around.